Okay. Hi, everyone. So glad to see you here. We are really excited about this webinar, how it's going to be fun and interactive and helpful to you, where everybody can share their ideas. My name is Tu Phillips, and I, at CORE, I serve as the curriculum design officer. And I'm so happy to be here with my fabulous colleague, Amy, and all of you, and some of our other CORE staff here to support. Welcome.
And I'm Amy Flans, and I am the program officer here for cultural orientation. And we are also being joined by a few other core staff who are here to help us on the back end this morning. Our logistics as we get going with this webinar, we do always have that transcription available and it is turned on. So if that does help you, you can click that closed caption CC button in your Zoom toolbar. This webinar is being recorded, and that recording will come out to you with the PowerPoint, with the links, with the resources, within about 48 hours. So the goal will be to have that out to you by Monday in your email. This webinar especially is going to be very interactive. We are hoping that you will share with each other when we do have a few breakout rooms during this session. That you'll respond in the chat to prompts, and that you'll maybe write down any questions that you have so that you can share those questions with either your fellow colleagues or with our core staff. As we get started, we're always thinking about who is with us in this room, who is with us to learn more about this curriculum. And so when we registered, we asked participants what was the level of experience they already had using these materials. And a good portion of us have done some type of training already about using the curriculum, or we've investigated some of the components. Some of us have planned sessions and led CO sessions using the curriculum, which is fabulous. And then there's this group of us that just kind of know the curriculum is there. We've heard about it. We're not really 100% sure, or we don't know much more about it besides it exists. So we do want to emphasize that this is a deeper dive, and we are hoping to have to move us a little further on using the curriculum. If there are pieces today that feel a little bit abstract or a little bit beyond you, don't worry at all. We are here for you and we want you to take as much as you can from this webinar. Our goals in this webinar session, we are hoping to have everybody learn a little bit more about how other CO providers are using and adapting the curriculum. We are going to spend some time exploring the adult education foundational principles using the curriculum. And then we're also going to be sharing with you a few different templates that you can use as a provider to create your own review games, scenarios, and sorting activities. And you see that first objective is bolded because that's going to be our priority today, providing some space for providers from across the United States to share how they have been using the curriculum in a guided format. I'm going to pass us back over to Tu, and Tu is going to ground us back in the why and the how and the what of the curriculum to give us some common language to use throughout our session today.
Thanks, Amy. So glad to have all of you here. And the way we look at this is that today we're coming together as a community of CO providers. And we may be in all different places, literally, all across the country. We're in different places, but we're also in different places in our use of the road ahead. But no matter where you are, each of us have a lot to share. So we're going to take a moment to ground ourselves in the curriculum. The ideas behind the curriculum, and then we'll invite you to take a moment to get to know each other. So, what is the road ahead? So, if someone were to ask you that question, how might you answer? Give you a moment to think about that. And so, this is how we've been answering it. We talk about it being a user-friendly and adaptable domestic CO curriculum, and we want it to be a foundational resource for CO programming, no matter where you are. Wonder if that's similar to what you might say. So when it comes to the why, this is why we created this resource. We know how important CO is in the resettlement process, and we know how hard all of you work to help your clients and serve your clients get used to their new life in the United States. And our goal is to provide this curriculum support to CO providers across agencies and location to give you a solid starting place. So you may already be familiar with the three components of the road ahead, and you're probably spending most of your time with the slides. And that's understandable because that's where all the content and activities are. All the client-facing materials are in the slides. But also, we just invite you to, if you haven't looked at it recently, revisit the session planning guides and the curriculum overview as well, because they can be a planning resource, a training resource, or a reference as you are planning, facilitating, and reflecting on your CO programming. So, when we were creating this resource, what we set out to do was to provide CO content in meaningful ways. Based on how people learn, we intentionally organize the content so that clients can make connections and retain information. We also try to make it be the client-facing materials to be accessible to a variety of learners using plain language, visuals, and use of home language. And finally, we also wanted to make it be user-friendly for CO providers. Most of the materials in one place, it's easy to modify to fit your context. And so we hope that you see these intentions reflected in the materials and that they serve you in the way that we intended. So some of you may be using the Road Ahead as a resource of curriculum materials, pulling from it what you need. Some of you may be using it as use our default settings, like our preset groupings of topics connected by universal themes. So take a moment to review the session themes and related topics, and you may know this quite well. So Amy's going to slowly review each session. So if you are using our default settings, you'll see these topics show up in these particular sessions. And you might notice that session four seems to be heavy with topics. And just note that the topics with the asterisk at the end are topics that may be wrapped up in session four, but they're introduced naturally in some of the other topics. You know, for example, rights and responsibilities would be something that is naturally embedded in a conversation about safety, in a conversation about housing, and so forth. So we just took a little bit of time to share just some foundational things about the road ahead, especially our thinking at core as we were developing it. So now we're going to invite your participation. So take a moment to think. What is something that you know about the road ahead, or something that you wonder about, something you want to know? And we're going to invite you to share your thinking with us and with each other in the chat. So take a moment to think, and then we'd love to see where you are. We'll monitor the chat.
Courtney, that makes me so happy to see that. I hope you feel it's user-friendly because you've been using it and you see that it's user-friendly, not just that we tell you, hey, it is user-friendly. I hope that you're seeing that in action as well. Rebecca, great question, thinking about the timing and the delivery of it. Yes, it is structured as multiple sessions, as four separate sessions. Rebecca, I'm going to send out to everybody the webinar that we did 2 weeks ago, which is that very base information, and encourage you to watch through that very basic information, which will show the structure of the overall curriculum. Regan, absolutely. It is adaptable to various contexts. We want it to be adaptable to be used in a classroom setting, as embedded in services, in a home delivery, virtual settings, et cetera. Julie, wonderful. Absolutely. It's meant to be adaptable to meet the needs of different people that you were working with, different language groups, different literacy levels, et cetera. Susie, absolutely. The timing and the delivery. So we're thinking again about those four sessions structured those into different lessons, each session with multiple lessons. But as we'll show you when we go through today, we absolutely encourage you to modify the timing, modify the delivery based on what your context needs. Maricela, this is a question that we get the absolute most, right? We need to we'll touch on that at the end of this webinar, the question of translations and additional languages. This is going to lead us in then to putting together our first small breakout conversation. Two is going to give us a little bit of information about that.
Sure, I'm going to give you some guidance about what's going to happen in the breakout rooms and offer you some examples. And then Amy's going to set us up into smaller groups to discuss. So what brings us all together today is that we're using or want to use the road ahead in one way or another. And it's just so helpful to learn from one another. As we were, when we launched this curriculum last September, we had some ideas about how people might use it, but we've learned so much from when you talk to each other. So, because you come up with different ways to adapt and use, and your questions help us problem solve and improve the curriculum. So we want to make this a forum for that today. So we're going to have two breakout rooms for group conversations. And this first one is just for you to learn about each other and about the CO context that you are working with, because how you use a curriculum is really dependent on the context of your delivery, what's expected in your agency. So when Amy opens up the breakout rooms, when you get there, you'll take some time to introduce yourself, then you talk about your CO context, and then once everybody has shared, just have an open conversation about, just ask each other questions and make connections. Here are some examples. So the question is, how is CO organized at your site? And so over the past year, when we talked with local sites and say, how is CO organized at your site? We always have to add the line at this time, because most sites would say that they're constantly updating and changing, looking for the best way to organize CO within the means that they have. So I hope that you can relate to that. Here are some responses to give you an example and see if there's so many different ways to organize CO. So maybe there's some connections you make to these examples or not. So site one would say, when we asked them about that, they said that the way they do it is they have two staff members who are dedicated to designing and providing CO, and they bring in other staff as needed. The timing of theirs is they do use around 12 hours when they have one session. The first session is like a half day session, 2 hours or so, to get people acquainted, and there's some content. And then they bring people back the next week with like a full day of content. So they're really choosing two sessions in one day with a break in between. And then they close out the following week with another 3 hour session. So it's spread over 3 weeks, is their approach. Site two, at this site, there's one staff member who's responsible for creating materials and designing what is to be presented. And then she shared all that information with other people in her agency, and many people use the materials to present cultural orientation. Case managers, other RA staff, and volunteers, but they typically do all their cultural orientation online. That's their default, and people can do makeups in person if they prefer, but typically they do it online. And then a third site that we talked to, at this site, there are four little sub-sites, and there's one CO leader for all the sites. So when they do cultural orientation, they bring all four clients from all four sites together. The case managers make arrangements for them to all be together, and the case managers attend the CO with their clients so that they can have some natural conversations about about the content. And the way they do it is they do 2 full days, and they make that be the day where they come into the physical location of the RA, and they have contact with other staff. CO in the morning, lunch break, CO in the afternoon, and then other times for people to connect with other staff members. So those are three different ways that COs organize based on conversations we have with each other. And I know you may have something similar or something slightly different. And so now it's your turn. And I will invite you, oh, Amy, I'll invite you to tell us more about what it's going to look like.
Fabulous, fabulous. It looks like everybody is back out with us. I hope that was a quick introduction to a few other providers. I know it can feel very awkward, uncomfortable to go into a sudden breakout room. I thought I was going to a webinar where I could just sit for an hour and do nothing. Now you're asking me to talk and share and participate. We're just trying to create this location where people can share their experiences while using the curriculum. You're going to be back with those same providers in a little bit later in this hour. If you have questions for somebody, you heard something interesting, you want to connect a little bit deeper with that person, maybe make a note of their name and be ready when you are going back in for that next breakout space. Before we move into a deeper conversation on the curriculum, Tu is going to walk us through some thoughts about how to use, modify, and adapt the curriculum. We're going to share with you some information from other providers. And then after that is where we're going to give you some space to talk about your own experience using the curriculum. Two, I'm going to mute myself and you go right ahead.
Thanks everyone for sharing. It's really interesting to hear how you organize CO, and I know it has to do a lot with the people that you're serving and the resources that are available to you. And we want to support you no matter what your organization might be. And we appreciate your creativity and making the adaptations to work in your context. So we'll look at different ways to use, modify, and adapt the road ahead. And I'm going to share with you some of what we heard from other people, from other providers that sharing their practices and some of their questions. And then we'll give you a space to talk to each other like you did and share some of your practices and questions within this community of providers. So there are as you talked, we really invite the adaptation. We think about the road ahead being a good starting place, and then you do what you make modifications. It could be very minimal modifications to very high modifications. As much you modify as much or as little as you want to make it work in your context. I'm going to share some things that people have told us that they've done. And as I'm sharing these, feel free to make your own personal connections. Maybe you do it too, or you may say, I'm going to tweak that a little bit. So you can modify the road ahead at the curriculum level, at the session level, or at the lesson level. So, at the curriculum level, many sites have opted to use the curriculum mostly as offered if they're doing a RMP process. They add their own branding or sometimes change the color scheme to match their agency's color scheme so people recognize it as part of their local agency. Some sites keep the four session structure, but they say that they like the flow of the four session, but they blend their own curriculum materials into it. So taking out things that don't apply and adding things that are unique to their community or their site. And some sites change the order of the session. Sometimes people combine the sessions, like I mentioned, like sometimes when they do 2 full days, they bring it to they combine the sessions, so 1 and 2 together and 3 and 4 together. And some sites use the curriculum as offered, but they vary the format. So, for example, they might do some sessions in person and some sessions virtually because they can't always get their folks to a central location. In the slide decks, you're going to see there are 3 lessons for every session. And if you're picking and choosing, using it as a curriculum resource, you'll see what the 3 lessons are in the introduction, but you also can see the color coding in the slide background to help you figure out which things you need to lift. So some users rearrange the lessons, building their own versions of each session by combining the topics that they want to bring to folks. So for example, I just was talking to a CO provider who says that he likes the welcome introduction, but he also would like to bring all the public assistance information there because that's what his clients are most are very interested in the very beginning. All right, so those are curriculum modifications that this if you're using the entire curriculum. So at the session level, here are some ways that let's start with the structure of each of the sessions. So every session starts with an opening to build community, introduce facilitators, interpreters, review topics, and set expectations. And then there are three lessons, and all the lessons are connected by a common theme. And each lesson is very tightly aligned with what is expected in the objectives and indicators. And then there's a closing. Well, you may notice if you're using the curriculum that not all the lessons are of the same length. Some topics require deeper exploration and some shorter. So here are some of the common modifications at the session level. People expand or condense various lessons depending on the interests of their clients. Sometimes they cut a lesson out, giving limited time, they may pull out, they just may do just two lessons within a session, or they switch a lesson. Although, for example, we put, here's how we would present safety. There might be some other ways of presenting safety. For example, I think some of you talked about like maybe this is where local law enforcement comes in and do their presentation instead of what core is putting in the curriculum. And then people change the community builders or reflection activities. So at the lesson level, here's what we hear that people do. So there are 12 lessons in the road ahead, and we usually organize three per session. Each of the lessons has four elements. So no matter which lesson you're choosing, you will see these elements. There's an opening in every lesson, and in the opening, there's an opportunity to create interest or offering participants a chance to share what they already know. We know that new learning happens when it can be connected to prior learning, and we need to do that for it to stick. So getting people to talk about, their own experience of what they already know and do will be a give you a chance to see where you're starting with, but also give you a chance to build on and connect to what people know about, for example, their practices for safety, for employment, and health, for example. Then every session has essential information, and in the road ahead, the essential information can be presented directly using visuals and your remarks to share information, or sometimes this essential content is presented through a video or the Settle In video or a Settle In app. Then there's a learning activity, always an opportunity for people to talk about the new content, apply the new content, reflect on it. And this will help people to think about nuances and how things may work in the outside of CO, in the world, in their local community. And it also helps you as a CO provider to assess what's clear to folks and what might be some misconceptions. And finally, there's a closing for giving people a chance to reconnect to their prior knowledge or to and to or to the theme. So typically, when people modify at the lesson level, sometimes they cut one of these elements. So although each element has a purpose, sometimes with time you may have to cut an element. But more commonly, what people tell us that they do is instead of cutting, they replace it with a different way of doing it. So, for example, people still share essential content, but their essential content might be different than what we are sharing because of their local context. Or they give people an opportunity to practice and apply the learning, but in a different kind of activity, different ways of doing activity. So, the one that's built in. So we love hearing from providers. So those are things that people have told us that they do, but they also share questions with us. And here are some common questions. And we'll just invite you to think about making connections to the questions or to the practices that people have. So before we invite you to share your practices, we'll offer you some of the common questions, and then we'll offer some of our responses, some of our thoughts, but please use this forum to share some, think about how you would respond to. All right, so here's the first question. And this is a very common one. I have less time for CO than the road ahead suggests. How would I make it work?
My click wasn't working there. So At COI, we have a few different recommendations for managing those time constraints when we think about CO or the curriculum. And this can be really difficult, but at that programmatic level, we really encourage you to advocate for more time for CO. We know that cultural orientation is one of those vital pieces of clients feeling empowered and feeling self-sufficient in the United States. Having more time gives them more time to apply the learning, ask questions, and with that repetition, right? Really get that information solidly integrated. One thing that you can also do is get to know a little bit about your client's prior knowledge, their needs, their priorities. For example, get a feeling for what topic could be delivered more quickly. If a client comes in with a lot of knowledge already about digital technology, maybe you deliver that topic a lot faster, or you cut some pieces out of that topic, but that client is very interested in education for their children, so you spend more time on that topic, which, because it's a high priority. We really encourage you to think about which topics or which pieces of topics could be connected, embedded inside of other pieces of service. For example, maybe the housing section would be done with the clients in their home during housing orientation. Maybe the transportation section would be done with the clients while they're doing bus orientation or transportation orientation in your region. Some topics are better taught in a classroom. It's really hard to take US laws out into the community to teach it inside of services, but some topics could be integrated and embedded into those in the moment hands-on settings. And this leads into this thought of having a hybrid approach where some lessons are taught in person, maybe some lessons are offered online, and then some other pieces of the curriculum could be embedded in those services. Tu also mentioned this earlier, thinking about those lower priority topics, maybe cutting an element out of the lesson, right? You could cut out from this opening section, the application, or the closing section. You just never want to cut out that section two, which is that essential content tied to those objectives and indicators. And always when you're editing those slide decks, remember to hide your slides. Don't delete them. So you still have those slides to go back to in the future.
All right. Thanks, Amy. Here's another one. So we want to give our participants handouts, something that they can walk away with. Are there any handouts that go with the road ahead?
So this is a question that we get very often, and our short answer is no, there are no specific handouts that you must print for participants. But the long answer is that you can determine as an office if you would like to print something additional for your clients based on their needs or their literacy levels. You can use those slides to print out these slide note versions where you've got the slides in a low text version where there's space for clients to write things down. And I will include the instructions on how to print those out in the follow-up materials that come out to your email. You could also print out the fact sheets that go along with the topic that you're teaching. These fact sheets are high text, though, so they are really meant for those high literacy learners. They are available in the same 10 languages as the slide decks. And then always remember that you have that Settle In app or the YouTube videos, the Settle In videos, that you can encourage participants to review the content by going back to the app or viewing those videos.
Okay, so not all of our CO happens in the classroom. I provide CO to clients in their homes. They don't have any projectors or screens. How can I use the road ahead?
If you do CO during home visits, for example, that housing orientation, you can always bring your laptop, a tablet, an organizational device with you, pull up those slides and view them together side by side with your client. If access to the internet is unreliable, you could print and bring the curriculum in a book format, using those images to reinforce the messages as you have a conversation with clients. Bringing your phone again or a device from your agency to access the videos in the app. When you do go in to print the slides, you can print them just like we've done in these binders, one slide per page, And you're able to skip any slides that you want to and only print those client-facing slides and then put them into this binder that you could use again and again and again during your home visits.
So we provide CO virtually. What do we need to change in the road ahead to make that work?
So this content should be very easy for you to move into a Zoom, a video conferencing, a Teams presentation because it is presented on slides. You would just need to work on adapting how you facilitate some of the activities. For example, the group conversations or the sorting activities, the ways that you do those pieces. You might also consider offering much shorter sessions more often, since we all know it's a lot harder to focus online than it is to focus in an in-person classroom setting. When we're thinking about adapting for virtual CO, there are a lot of like review games, sorting activities. Those pieces can move into a virtual setting much easier. Those discussions might take a little bit more adaptations, depending on what the participants need. Their comfort level, their access to devices, how many languages are present, all of those different pieces. When you are inside of those activity slides in the slide deck, you can look through the notes under them, review the directions, and think about how that might work for you and your clients.
Okay, so Amy and I just shared a bunch of things that we've heard from other CO providers, just like you, about how they use the road ahead and then the questions that come up. Now it's your turn. And we want you to take a moment. In just a moment, we're going to send you back to the breakout rooms. And in those rooms, we invite you to do two things. One, share your practices and perspectives. If you've been using the road ahead and you've come across some things that you think would be good to share with other folks, we just invite you to do that. How do you use it? What's helpful? And what are some tips that you might have? If you are relatively new, you can think about how might you use it. And you can also think about questions that you would might want to know. So this is an opportunity to say, what is it that I want to know about how other CO providers use this? And what can I share that can be supportive of this community?
As you're coming back, again, I hope that you had a moment to share, gather an idea from a fellow colleague. We never have a chance globally to really connect as CO providers. And so our goal in this day-to-day is to provide that space so that as a provider, you can connect a little bit with your colleagues globally. Again, like Tu said, we encourage you if a conversation started that you want to continue. Feel free to send that person a private message through the chat. Share your own contact information with somebody if you'd like to continue that conversation out of this webinar. As we get towards the end of this hour, we do want to share with you a few more pieces of maybe support, guidance on going into using the curriculum further, as well as some different templates that you can use to continue to modify and specialize that curriculum for yourself and your agency. Another common question that we hear from providers is this idea that we don't have a background in teaching. So how do we use the curriculum when we don't have a lot of teaching experience? And so one of the things that we always emphasize is that this curriculum was consciously designed around the best practices in adult education. If you've been in a CORE webinar before, CORE always refers to these best practices as the keys to effective cultural orientation. And three of these things that are embedded throughout the curriculum are things like thinking about the cognitive load. How difficult is it for clients to focus? Using student-centered learning and making sure that clients' strengths are always a focus in the session as well. For example, in the curriculum slides, you'll see that cognitive load is managed through using less text, very simple visuals, recurring routines and activities that happen throughout every lesson so that clients and providers are focused on the content instead of being focused on learning the structure of a new activity. You'll see student-centered principles throughout the curriculum in how we modify that curriculum for all the various levels of clients. and that the refugees' backgrounds are continually brought into the sessions and the lessons. And then you'll see that there's opportunities embedded throughout the curriculum for refugees to lead those conversations, take back that power and control over their own learning, and help guide the conversations. And so I'm just going to show you a few different slide examples where we see these best practices kind of embedded throughout the curriculum. For example, when we think about modifying content for the various levels, this section from the role of the refugee, or role of the resettlement agency, has a variety of different slides that you can use for a scenario conversation. Maybe you're hiding the slides with text and you're just using the slide with a photograph so that clients are not being overwhelmed if they have very low literacy. Maybe your clients have high literacy, so you're hiding the other slides and you're showing the slide with the most text here because the client can read and engage with that literacy as well during the session. All of the slides and sessions are meant to connect into clients' lived experience. There's perpetually options for clients to share, what was this like in your home country? How is it the same or how is it different from the United States? What have you already seen in your time here in the United States? And how does that relate to your prior experience? Valuing that background that the client and the refugee brings into the learning environment. And then again, encouraging clients to take the lead. Tell us, what do you already know about, housing in the United States? This lets us value the prior experience of the client, and it also lets us learn a little bit more about what maybe can we spend less time on. If the client knows a lot about housing in the United States, maybe I can spend a little bit less time on those basics and more time on talking about like the housing crisis or the housing crunch that we're facing right now. Always, always encouraging clients to provide the information that they already have to be able to lead those conversations. We go through these examples again to comfort you, to encourage you that this curriculum is designed for people who don't have a lot of teaching background. Right? You don't have to be a master's degree educator to lead people through this curriculum. It's structured very thoughtfully for CO providers. A few additional pieces that are included, and we want to encourage you to always go back to. Inside of that curriculum overview, there are additional guidance pieces that give some of the whys. Why is this piece included, connected to those adult education principles? There are also some beautiful templates inside of that curriculum guide that help you to kind of prepare for what questions and interruptions you will get, because we know that those questions often get us off topic and really losing our time when we are already very crunched for time in our sessions. These guides can be ongoing documents that you continue to update. You print them out or you keep a running document on your computer, and you continue to add to them and update over time, helping you to keep your sessions on task. As we kind of get towards the end of our session today, I wanted to give you just a moment to kind of catch your breath. We've talked a lot about different ways to modify, use the curriculum in different ways, how those adult education practices are embedded in the curriculum. And I want to just do a quick check-in and ask how you're feeling. And I invite you to share in the chat. And I'm going to ask you to do this on a face of dog. So I'm wondering which dog here best represents how you're feeling at this moment. My hope is that you're not feeling like number five, where you have to go bury your head in the sand because you are so frightened and overwhelmed. Hopefully you're feeling like maybe number four. Amber, feeling a little bit like number six, excited. Maybe you're feeling a little bit like number seven. Oh my gosh, I did not even have that thought. I am feeling a little shocked and maybe shook, like what opportunities are available. Maybe you're feeling a little bit like number eight. This has been a lot of information for 53 minutes. Absolutely understand being a cat person, Christy. I go back and forth between using a cat images and dog images for this one. Happy to see a lot of threes. This like cheerful, excited dog. So far, no number twos, this little sad dog here in the corner. So a lot of us also feeling like this number nine, just comfortable, excited. Fabulous. Thank you so much for sharing that. Catching your breath, and we're going to share just a few more pieces with you before we close out for our day. We do want to share some templates with you that you can use to create your own activities, games, scenarios to again personalize that curriculum more for your part of the United States. We do have people reach out to us and say, we really like those games. A few people have put that in the chat today. Our clients love those games. Can you make more? Can you make more scenarios? And our answer is, because CO is so varied with such different needs across the country, what we have done is created some very flexible templates that you can use to duplicate and design identical activities to use on any of the topics. Two, will you give me a thumbs up that you see the templates right now? Okay, fabulous. I never know when I'm sharing my screen if I've shared it correctly, if everybody's seeing what I'm seeing. So we're gonna share this slide deck link with you. Just like when you go to the regular slide decks for the sessions, this one is a view only. You have to download it to edit it and use it offline. And you'll do that by coming up to this file in the corner, either make a copy if you use Google, or download as a PowerPoint. And then once it's downloaded, you can duplicate, edit, adapt, copy, paste, etc., as much as you would like. So we have in here templates that include the yellow text as the example, followed by slides that you can duplicate. I want to create a quiz about housing. I duplicate this slide. I type in my question. If the answer to that question is yes, I'm going to use this slide next. If the answer to that question is no, I'm going to use this slide next. So I've got all of these, we have all of these different templates in here. You can create additional scenarios that you want to insert, maybe photographs that are relevant to your location, additional conversation questions, additional sorting activities. If you really love those sorting activities, we have the example in here followed by some template slides that you can copy, duplicate, and create your own activities. And then a few more down here at the bottom. This slide deck, again, is going to come out to you in your email so that you can pull from that to, again, personalize, adapt, modify the curriculum to fit your clients. All of these items that CORE makes are considered public domain. That means there's no copyright. You are free to modify, duplicate, change things around. You just can't sell them, right? That's the only place that we get paid. We also encourage you to go back to CORE's activity bank if you're looking for more activities, for example, on housing. You need a few additional ideas for housing. Going back to that activity bank to pull out additional housing ideas. And I'll link that in our follow-up email as well. We want to remind you that we do have those slide decks available in 10 different languages. These languages are determined by Bureau of Population, Refugees, Migration, PRM, and the funding is provided then for specific translations. Only those client-facing slides are translated. So if you download the Ukrainian slide deck, the client-facing slides are in Ukrainian, the instructor notes and the hidden slides are still in English. Right now, we don't have any plans to add additional languages. This is like the number one question that CORE gets every day of the week, every month of the year, is when are we going to get another language? When will we have French, Tigrinya? These are our biggest requests all the time. And we are just so restricted by the funding that we have. And those decisions are made kind of above CORE's level. But all of those materials are public domain. So if you have the ability to fund some translations on your own, you are very, very welcome to do that. And we can help support you in that process. All of those slides that are translated are available on that webpage where you download the sessions from. And you see them in this long list of languages. As we talked about briefly earlier and Karina asked, our staff is here to schedule with you specific training for your organization, your staff, your network, give you some guidance on modifying the curriculum, look at what modifications you've done and help you with them, help you access those templates. If you're like, okay, I see all these great pieces that you have, but I've got no digital skills. How am I going to use these? Reach out to us and connect so that we can set up some time to work together with you. We are getting right to the end of our hour, and so we are hoping that you have gained quite a few different ideas, thoughts, excitements from other participants today, from the ideas that Tu and I have shared with you on further modifying the curriculum. We'd love if you feel comfortable to share something in the chat. What will be the next steps that you take after you leave this webinar? Next thing that I am going to do, I will something, something, something. Sandra, this is a great question. Let's connect after the webinar. I'll send you an email so that we can get you that information, okay? I'd love if you would share something quick in the chat. What's going to be your step while you leave this webinar? What are you going to do with the curriculum next? And maybe it's just, I will download the curriculum, right? That's absolutely a perfect next step. As you're thinking and sharing those next steps, and before we close out for our hour, we would love to invite you to complete our post survey. That webinar survey can be brought up by the link in the chat. You can scan that QR code to bring up the survey and give us some feedback on how this little training opportunity went with you for you this morning. Amber, I know the time. My God, I wish I could just, I have, that's the magic bullet, right? Is that I can give you that time to dig into the information. I do encourage you always to subscribe to that core newsletter so that you can continue to see when new resources are released, when new information is being shared. I see a few great things coming through the chat. Evgen is going to read through the materials and see how it can be pulled out into overseas CO. Fabulous. Amber, we're going to work with you to try and find that time. If I find that magic answer, Amber, I'm going to reach out to you right away. Karina's going to read everything through from top to bottom so she can start planning. Molly's going to be encouraging clients to connect that curriculum more to their prior experience. Absolutely. Bring in those client skills that they already have, right? They have the skills. We just need to help the clients transfer those skills into this new environment. Tana's thinking about downloading through everything, reading through to share with the staff and your organization. Safwan is going to be using some of the content for overseas CO. Absolutely. Pull those images out, duplicate, use the same format. Clients have seen that format overseas. They see the same format in the United States. It continues that comfort feeling. Amber's maybe thinking about connecting with the ESL department there. Sandra is going to be sharing that with their team. I'm going to turn off my share here for you. I would like to close us out with just a giant thank you. We had a huge amount of people registered. We expect a lot more people to be coming today. And we are so happy that those of you who came did come and shared your ideas, shared your information and your background. We appreciate you every time that you come, that you ask questions, that we can share more information with you. Like Tu said earlier, we learn as much from you as you learn from us. We go back and we modify materials to make them more usable for you based on the comments and the conversations that we have. We are here to help you use the curriculum, modify, adapt, personalize it, and provide that training to you or your staff if it's needed, when it's needed. Thank you for coming. Thank you to the providers. Yeah, too. Thank you. Thank you as providers for everything that you do. We are really just here to help support you to make sure that your clients are supported as best as we can.